Wayne Gretzky has both Oilers goals, and they are two periods away from the Stanley Cup championship. Two goals in front after one period of this game. Bob Johnson said he was very proud of his Calgary Flames after they came oh so close at a period and a half from beating the Edmonton Oilers in the division championship. And what the Oilers have done since has done nothing but add to your pride, I'm sure.
Well, we came so close, and we faced the same situation the Oilers did coming tonight. We were down three games to one coming back in this building, and we were fortunate enough to win here. We went back to Calgary and won it again and came back to the seventh game. And but they've got it going pretty good now, Edmonton. You know, they're a great flow team, and I think if you can keep that flow off their game, you have a chance. Once they get it going, they have so many honest, pure scorers out there. And, you know, you didn't hear from Gretzky for a while. Now you're hearing from Gretzky, and they still haven't heard from Curry yet either, and he's a great scorer.
You made a lot of changes wherever they seemed obvious and maybe where they didn't seem obvious. Could the Islanders have tried anything like that, or do they just have to go out and play their game and hope it's good enough?
I think New York, they're a hurting hockey team right now. They came through three tough grueling series, and they're physically down, but I think mentally they might be down a little bit too from the standpoint some of their players are tired, some are playing injured, and the amazing thing about the whole playoffs, Edmonton seems to be healthy with the exception of a player here and there. They look like it's training camp again. No, I think you have to keep Edmonton off their game. And that's hard to do, but you can't let them get it going because they're the number one team in the league. You know, if you look very carefully, they've scored more goals than anybody, and they've won more games, and they're a highly organized offensive machine, and you have to do something to take away that offensive flow.
What about the roles of favorite and underdog? I'm sure you benefited from the fact that the Oilers were the favorite against Calgary, and I seem to think that the Oilers are having fun as the underdogs, if you will, against the four-time champions in this series.
Right, and also I think the crowd has been outstanding here in Edmonton. There's great electricity in the building tonight. You know, if you're a player out there, you seem to get the loose pucks and you go a little bit harder and you want to make those great plays because the crowd is with you. And of all the teams in the league, in fact, all the teams in hockey, I think the Edmonton Oilers are the toughest team to play catch-up with. Once you start the gamble, you're pinching a defenseman, you're taking some offensive chances, they just jump on those and they get you like the last goal is a 3-on-1, and all of a sudden you look at the scoreboard and you're down. The key to it is don't get many 3-on-2s or 2-on-1s, and the key is to make sure that they're playing catch-up with you because they take more chances than any team in the game of hockey. So when you fall behind, they become very, very difficult to catch up. The next goal is the most important goal of the series.
A lot of coaches have had to live in the Patrick Division looking up at the Islanders for four straight years. Do you have a sense that the Smythe Division is going to be a case of trying to catch Edmonton for a while?
Well, you know, I told somebody before the game tonight, in the last 2 years, we played them 32 times. We played them 17 times this year, Edmonton, and we're very, very familiar. We know what they can do, but I think our team gained a lot of confidence in the playoff. You know, we beat them three times, and our players left the series in the playoff with a very positive note that if we work a little bit harder and get a little bit more maturity, maybe there's a chance anyway, and we're looking forward to playing them again next year.
Well, congratulations on the three-year contract that you got for coming close. Imagine if you'd beaten the Oilers. Well, Bob Johnson of the Calgary Flames, and he talked about those fans, and so will some people who will analyze them in a professional manner next as our first intermission resumes in a moment. Gretzky twice in the first period. Yari Curry assisted on both goals. The Oilers lead 2-0. John Wells is witnessing this potentially historic game from the stands, and he tells us more about what the fans might mean to the Oilers' cause.
Dave, there has been a remarkable contrast in the noise, enthusiasm, and just plain good times in the stands since this final series moved to Edmonton three games ago. Traditionally, Edmonton hockey fans have been known as a rather quiet lot. Well, not anymore. And their boisterous fan support for the Oilers has had its effect on the Oilers' standing in this series after four games. Everyone having a great time.
You got goosebumps at home? We got them here.
I think when you can feel the electricity in the air that the fans generate, it gets everyone's adrenaline going. And we've tried to delay going onto the ice a few minutes because we know that the fans are going to get the building whipped into a fever before we get out there.
And now the Oilers come out, and of course there's an eruption. The building erupts. Well, of course, that can be used very positively. And, of course, the player can get a tremendous uplift from that surge of appreciation that he'll feel. And psychologically, of course, it's going to put them in a very good frame of mind to compete. They have to keep that there, though, for as long as they possibly can. And that's why, of course, scoring first is so important in this game.
If you'll think back, we scored a goal and got another one right away, and I think the enthusiasm by the people has gotten us that second goal right away. We're very explosive, but those people were still on their feet from the first goal when we scored our second one. I think they're worth a couple of goals in the two games we've played at home.
I know what it feels like to be at home and playing with a big crowd behind you like that. And when you go into the opposition building like we are right now, it's a matter of shutting it out and blocking out the fans and going out there and trying to beat the Oilers and the fans.
One of the big things, though, going into game four was, of course, the expectancy behind Billy Smith that he would come up with the big one. And I think Billy Smith rather hoped to do that, but he didn't. And because he didn't, that altered the whole concept of the game. In fact, Gretzky wanted to score just as much as Billy Smith wanted to shut him out, but Gretzky got the better of the day. And that altered the game. And of course, with an immediate follow-up of another goal, Billy Smith must have been psychologically harmed, to say the least.
What do you think has turned the Edmonton fans off?
There's that feeling of affiliation with a very highly skilled unit, a very successful team, a team that is providing a tremendous amount of excitement and aggression and intimidation, if you like, on the rink. And I think the fan really can emotionally equate with that.
Our emotion level is at its highest ever. I'd have to say we've finally peaked after 5 years. The fans, the crowd, and the players overall, our confidence level, we're at a peak right now.
We hope a little insight into what makes hockey a little more special for everyone involved at this time of the year. Dave?
And those fans only get louder as the Oilers get closer to the Stanley Cup championship. The look at the playbook, courtesy Howie Meeker, as our coverage of the Stanley Cup championship continues. A celebration of excellence comes to CBC television on June 4th as the NHL presents its stars with trophies to recognize their outstanding performances. See Gretzky, Langway, Coffey, and other stars June 4th, the NHL Awards presentation for the first time live on CBC.
Stanley Cup 84. Our Hockey Night in Canada coverage continues Tuesday if Game 6 in the final series is necessary. It's back to the Nassau Coliseum on Long Island if the New York Islanders can slow down the fast-skating Oilers in Game 5 tonight. Game 6, if necessary, Tuesday at 6 Mountain, 8 Eastern on Hockey Night in Canada.
Now let's open the playbook. Here is Howie Meeker.
Folks, Oilers, 15 goals in 5.5 periods. What are they doing? Well, basically, they're taking advantage of Islander mistakes. You'll see the Islanders here shoot the puck in, and it will end up in the corner. And Boudelier, a defenseman, comes in here and skates right by the puck. He sees the possible check coming. I think he loses his concentration. Curry comes back and picks it up. And while all this is going on, watch number 99 curl and get in perfect position to take the pass. All right, there's the puck shot in, and of all things, Boudelier's going in there. Now you see Foglund heading for the corner. Boudelier knows he's going to get the check. Now keep your eye on Boudelier. Here's the penalty. There's the penalty. Top of your screen. That's Gretzky. That pass from Curry right on his stick, and he's home free. Now watch him hide the puck here. He takes it to his backhand, hides it, cuts across in front of the net, and slips it underneath Smith's left shoulder. I thought a very amateur effort by Smith, but oh, what a goal by Gretzky.
Tough enough to beat this Edmonton team without giving them chances like that. And the 3-on-1 with Gretzky second.
Well, it's the little things that really hurt you. Here again, you see the Islanders with the puck right in this position here. All right, roll it from here. Now they have to shoot it in. Stop it right there. Look at, there's no way in the world they're going anywhere. He's stopped. Look at all the players right in here. And look at, there's the only possible pass receiver. And he's checked and blocked out. Now you have to dump the puck in. Nope, a little back pass. And wait, Curry's got the puck again. And he plays the smart deal. Look, Gretzky comes late. Stop it right here. Now, at this point here, this defenseman has to do something. He can't back up. He has to say, I've got to make Gretzky shoot from here or pass from here. And he would have done it, I think, pretty successfully. But watch the snapshot. See him snap that puck in? Just two great goals, but I tell you, both made possible by breaking simple fundamental rules. Hey, I have to get the puck in the corner. Four guys lined up, I got to shoot it in.
The Islanders' dressing room is located within earshot of our studio, and as they left to go out in the second period, there was a lot of let's go Rolly shouts, and this is why, because Billy Smith is on the bench and Roland Melanson is the Islander goaltender to start this second period of play. Let's go to the broadcast booth.
Stanley Cup Replay is brought to you by Apple Computers and authorized Apple dealers throughout Canada.
Just as in Game 4, Wayne Gretzky opened the scoring on a breakaway. 12:08, Yari Curry had given him the pass. Gretzky went to the forehand this time, took Billy Smith all the way, and then somehow got the puck by him, and it was 1-0 for the Oilers. Same combination results in the second. Oiler goal, Curry breaks away, has Semenko on his left, and has Gretzky coming from behind. Gretzky's the one who gets the pass and who scores the goal, and Edmonton leads 2-0. In the second period, Roland Melanson goes into the Islander net. Kenny Linsman scores his first goal of the final, and Yari Curry does the same on an Edmonton power play. He scored plenty of goals this season like that. Edmonton leads 4-0 going to the third period.
Stanley Cup Replay is brought to you by Apple Computers and authorized Apple dealers throughout Canada. Progressive Conservative leader Brian Mulroney is Peter Pocklington's guest at this hockey game tonight. It's a pleasure to welcome them both to our telecast on Hockey Night in Canada. I noticed, Peter, a couple of nights ago, Game 2, you had Premier Lougheed in your seats, and it didn't work out that well. Have you brought in the recruit?
Well, we brought in a new recruit. I think you'll see tonight that you got a champion like Brian. Things are going to change.
Brian, I suppose you dazzled them pretty good back in the old days on the ponds in Quebec.
Well, this is just like Baie-Comeau, you know. Hockey of the same quality. I think it's a great game, offensively and defensively. I think we've got a big winner back in Canada.
Now, what would have happened had it been the Montreal Canadiens here tonight? How would you have figured that one out?
Edmonton is playing in the tradition of the Montreal Canadiens that Montreal's trying to rebuild. They're playing exactly like the Canadiens of old, and that's good to see.
Brian, a quick thought. What do you think of Peter Pocklington's hockey team?
I think it's superb. But he's done so well, built it so well in such a short period of time. It's tremendous.
Peter, you're only 20 minutes away. What emotions are running through your head right now?
I'm almost numb. In fact, it's like the birth of my first child. Only here, you wonder if it's ever going to come. It's been a long time coming, a long gestation period.
You said 5 years at one point, if I recall.
Yes, that's true, and this is it. 5 years, and we're there. It's pretty exciting for all of Alberta, and especially here in Edmonton.
Thank you very much to both of you, gentlemen.
Thank you.
All right, let's go up to Bob Cole. We're ready for third period action. Well, the victorious Edmonton Oilers dressing room captain Wayne Gretzky joins me with the Stanley Cup here. Wayne, there's been a lot of trophy presentations to you. As I recall, every time it was nothing means anything until we get the Stanley Cup.
You know, I was talking to the guys before the game, and I said that I've been fortunate enough to win a lot of individual awards, but those awards meant nothing like this thing. This is the ultimate. You never won a trophy until you won this, and I don't know how to describe it. I just want to thank all the people that have backed me all the time.
Wayne, an outstanding performance by the Edmonton Oilers hockey team through this series. When did you know that you really had a good shot at beating the Oilers? You had to believe in yourselves, and it took some time, didn't it?
I think we started believing when we won the first game 1-0. We got badly beat the second game, but then we bounced back and played tremendous hockey. And we played well the whole series. We might have had one bad game, but it doesn't matter. You get paid to win four games, and that's what we played for. We did it, and like I said, I say hello to all the guys down in L.A., David and Alan and Peter Watson.
Okay, Grant, just give me one more second here. We're getting a little bit damp in this celebration.
I waited for 25 years for this.
You haven't really waited all that long compared to a lot of other people. The hockey club tonight, going into the third period, two quick goals by the Islanders. Did you start to get a little bit concerned at that point?
We were a little nervous. You know, when that happens, you got to be a little nervous. And we kept playing and we kept going.
That stuff stings.
I didn't know that, that it stung like that. It does sting. You're right.
One quick thought about the defending champion New York Islanders, a great hockey club that you had to beat to win this.
Well, you know, they're great champions. We hope that we can be as good as they are. You know, they carried it, carried themselves professionally. We know we can. We hope we do. And you know, what can you say? They're a great hockey team. They might have had a few injuries, but we kept working hard and we played a tremendous hockey.
Thanks so much. Congratulations once again. One more happy Oilers with Dave Hodge in our other studio.
And NHL President John Ziegler is here. John, you're quite accustomed to presenting this Conn Smythe Trophy to a player in a white, orange, and blue uniform, except this crest says Oilers, not Islanders.
Mark, congratulations. You beat one of the great teams of all times, and it took a great team to do it. And among that greatness, you were the best. Congratulations.
Thank
on this year's winner is the Conn Smythe Trophy.
I don't really know what to say.
Say it was a close vote, because I'm sure it was.
God, my mother, I went to my mother's place before I went to Long Island, and I asked her what she thought about the series, and usually she doesn't say too much, but she said, you know, I can feel it in my blood, and, you know, that's all I needed to hear, and we went out there, and I can't say enough about the guys. We just a tremendous effort by everybody, and this, you know, this is just a kicker.
I tell you, if there was one goal that might be remembered above all others in this final, it was a goal that Mark Messier scored in the second period of Game 3 when the Islanders were ahead 2-1, and he took the puck at his own blue line. He went down to the other end, and it was 2-2, and the Oilers really never looked back after that. Mark, my congratulations, and from everybody across the continent to the 1984 Conn Smythe Trophy winner, let us return to the joy that you'll find in just a minute in your dressing room, John Wells.
All right, David, Paul Coffey joins me now. Paul, describe the feeling in the third period when the Islanders got two quick goals.
It was a very, very scary feeling, John. I think that right then we knew that the Islanders are a true championship hockey club. I mean, they could have died, but they come out and got two quick ones. And, hello, it was just a kind of a scary feeling. We had to keep taking a play to them. Unfortunately, we did, and we won.
Do you believe this has happened to the Edmonton Oilers now?
Unbelievable, John. I think that they'll probably sink in tomorrow, but I'll tell you one thing. It's the best feeling I've ever had in my life.
Paul, tell us about tonight's hockey game. What did the Oilers do to get such a quick lead and take command of the hockey game?
I think, John, what we tried to do in the first 10 minutes was not let the Islander team score. In the past, they've scored early on us. We just tried to come out, play hungry, pursue the puck, get on their key players, Blasi, Trache, Potvin, tire them out, and we were fortunate enough to come up with a couple of quick goals, and it worked perfect for us.
Congratulations.
Thanks
on an outstanding
much.
Series. Thanks, Paul Coffey. All right, here's Dave Hodge.
Well, Glenn Sather is rejoicing. As coach, as GM, and as president of this team, it's about as good a five-year plan as anybody could ever want to see. But I think the important thing about the fact that you've won it in 5 years is that you said you were going to do that. And a lot of people criticize you for that. I don't think you'd have this cup now, and maybe ever, if you hadn't had the confidence that you've got. I wonder whether you would agree.
Well, I appreciate that. I think that if you set out to accomplish something and you believe in it, you should say that you really believe in it. And for me, it was easy because I had a great bunch of guys that believed in me and believed in our team and believed in our effort and believed in themselves. And it was easy because I had an owner that believed in it. And when we told him what we were going to do and all the good people that have put things together with us in this organization, like Barry Fraser and Bruce McGregor, and I mean, you could go through everybody because they've all had an enormous part in this thing. But it all comes down to believing if you can really do it, and that's the first step. If you believe you're going to do it and you can make the people in your organization believe it, I think that you've got a chance. And we had so many people that have criticized us and knocked us for the way we played and the style of hockey we've had, but they keep forgetting that we were getting better as all that was happening. And I think that we've got a lot to do with changing what's happened with hockey lately. It's exciting, our fans are delirious, and it's a good brand of hockey to watch. We make mistakes, but we overcome them, and I think that we overcame them tonight. And it's a credit to our hockey club because they had enough courage to go out and do it tonight.
There are some people in the NHL who might not want to think about this or talk about this, but there are also some glasses being hoisted around the country from some people who used to play in a league called the World Hockey Association, and this is a milestone.
It is. I'm proud that I had a chance to be in that league because the team that was in Winnipeg and the team that was in Quebec when we played there in our first and second year were both great, great teams. And they showed us an awful lot about innovative hockey and the creative motion that Hedberg and Nielsen and Hull did. And to me, that line's still the best line I've ever seen play together. And that's really the way we tried to mold this hockey team, was after their free-flow style. But the guy that picked the hockey players, Barry Fraser, has got a lot to do with the style of team that we have. And John Muckler and Teddy Green, they're absolutely wonderful the way they work these things. And there's been so much talk about what we were doing to the Islanders. And Teddy and John were really the guys that put together our game plan, and we went out and did it.
Glenn, there are some people who know you better than I do who say the day you stop coaching and just manage and run this team will be one day after you've won a Stanley Cup. Do you want to stop coaching after one cup?
I don't even want to think about tomorrow. I just want to have some fun with the guys right now.
We'll let you do that. And those guys are with John Wells. Let's return.
Okay, Dave, there will be another Fogelin name on the Stanley Cup trophy as a result of the Oilers' victory tonight. You must be pretty proud, and Dad must be pretty happy watching back in Thunder Bay.
I'd like to say hello to all my family and friends in Thunder Bay, and I know my father wanted to come, but he's so nervous, I think he loses more weight than me during the game. He won the Stanley Cup in 48-49 with the Detroit Red Wings, and he told me it'd be a big thrill for me, and it certainly is.
You've been waiting for this a couple of years, longer than most of the Oilers. 10th season in the National Hockey League finally had come.
This is my 10th season in the league, and it's my third time to the finals, and I said, I can't lose the 33 times in a row, and it's just a great feeling, and I hope the Edmonton Oilers can be good champions as the New York Islanders were.
Lee, there has to be something in that statement, because the Islanders were very worthy champions for 4 years. Truly an outstanding hockey club that you had to beat to win the trophy.
Well, they completed a tremendous feat. They won four straight cups, and winning one is tremendously hard. They had a lot of injuries this year, and I know a lot of guys were just coming back, and it just seemed like we were hitting stride at the right time, but they certainly deserve a lot of credit, but I'm glad we brought the cup back to Canada.
What's first on your agenda as far as the celebration is concerned?
Well, I think I'm going to give my wife a great big kiss, because she's sure tolerated a lot the last 6 weeks. I've just been a tyrant to live with, and there's no rest period at all. And now it's over. It's like somebody takes 1,000 pounds off your back. It's a great feeling.
Thank you very much. Congratulations. Pat Hughes, thank you for joining us. Happy times is the second time for you.
It sure is, John, but I think this time's the best. Last time in Montreal, I really didn't have a big part of it, but tonight I really felt, and throughout these playoffs, that 20 guys were a big part of the win, and I felt a big part of it.
As far as the game tonight, were you a little concerned early in the third period when the Islanders came back, because you were playing a great hockey club?
Well, we had them in pretty good shape, 4-0 going into the third, and then a little lapse first minute, and they got right back in the game, but I think it woke us up. We had to tighten up, and we worked hard for the remaining 19 minutes and came up with a good effort, and had that empty netter, and here we are.
Thank you very much to Pat Hughes. Congratulations on number two. All right, Dave.
There will be more from the Oilers dressing room. We hope to have somebody, Bill Torrey, Al Arbor, a representative of the Islanders, to talk about a four-year reign and this end of an era, as we'll have more on Stanley Cup 84 in a moment. All champions should reign as proudly and lose as gracefully as the New York Islanders have done. I guess saying nothing lasts forever, Bill, doesn't wipe away the disappointment, though it does remain true.
Well, unfortunately, it does, David. Yeah, it's tough to give it up. We've enjoyed it. We want it back again. And I feel very proud of our team. We weren't a complete team, but we gave it everything that we had to give. And I'm very, very proud of them. I'd like to take this opportunity, though, to congratulate Edmonton. They played a great series. They were well prepared. They did what they had to do, and the opportunities we gave them, they cashed in.
If there's a question you'll ask yourself about this series, I'm suggesting it might be that spurt at the start of the third period. Why couldn't we have had it earlier?
Well, it's true. We made some mistakes tonight. I thought we came out pretty well. We started to play a little bit more like ourselves at the beginning of the game, and unfortunately we made a couple of mistakes, and as I say, all credit to the champions, the new champions. The opportunities we gave them, they cashed in.
You did not become the second team to win five straight Stanley Cups, but you are one of only two organizations to have won four in a row, and that remains with you. I guess the plans start to try for another drive for whatever.
Well, whatever. Like I say, we didn't give it up easily, and we're not happy about giving it up, but they earned it, and I hope they enjoy it for 1 year.
Well said, Bill Torrey. Now let's go back to that victorious Oilers dressing room.
Well, the first Stanley Cup for Kevin Lowe and the Edmonton Oilers. What's it feel?
John, it's
I think I got to ask the Montreal Canadiens and the New York Islanders and all the teams that won it what we're supposed to do, because I don't know what to do right now. You've seen this on TV before. We're doing all the usual things like pouring the champagne and drinking the champagne, but I just don't know what to do right now. I'm really happy. First of all, I want to say hello to all my family in Lachute, Nancy and David, my sister and brother-in-law, and everyone back there.
That'll save you the phone call later tonight.
That'll save us the phone call.
Third period tonight, they gave you a little bit of a scare.
They certainly did. I think we weren't overconfident by any means. We just had a couple bad breaks, and look at this treat. This is for everyone in Lachute. We just got a couple of bad breaks, and they got in the game, but Andy made some big saves, and we hung there tight. And we were a little scared, I must say, but we had a two-goal pad at that time, and we finished it off, John.
Is it everything you ever thought it might be?
It's just starting, John. It's just starting, believe me, and it's everything. The excitement, our fans were unbelievable throughout the three games here, and there's not much more I can say. I'm really happy, and it's just starting for us.
Thank you very much, Kevin Lowe. Dave Lumley is here. I know you want to say happy anniversary to someone, so get that one over.
Yeah, hello, Sheila. Happy anniversary. It's her 25th wedding anniversary this week. She wanted to fly out yesterday, but the kids were having a big surprise party for her, so she couldn't come out. Happy anniversary, Sheila. This is for you. This is a lot of fun.
Make
this
sure
is great.
Behind all the people in Banff, too.
I read about your hockey hero in the newspaper the other day, about Davy Keogh, and all the years that you've been dreaming of the Stanley Cup.
Boy, I'll tell you, I've been playing hockey for 25 years. You know, my dad built the rink for me in my backyard. And Davy Keogh, I always wanted to be like him when I grew up. You know, I got in a car accident when I was little, and he came to the hospital, gave me a stick, and he won a Stanley Cup in 67. I remember him skating around the ice in Toronto. I was there, and you know, now I'm here. This is great.
All right, who have we got? Here's Andy Mose. Come on in, Andy. Tense moments for you, I'm sure. Early moments of the third period.
Well, we knew they were going to come up pretty hard, and we knew we had to hold the fire, and I think we did exceptionally well, to tell you the truth. They got the two, and then they didn't get a really good chance after that, and that's a credit to my teammates.
One stage of the second period, the Edmonton Coliseum was alive with a cheer of Andy. And after they hadn't played all that much in the playoffs, it must have felt pretty special.
Well, I appreciate the chant, but I think it should have been defense. Those players in front of me were outstanding, and I can't say enough about them.
All right, Andy, congratulations on the victory tonight.
I'd like to say hello to my dad right now. I understand he's home and resting comfortably, and I hope he gets well soon, and we'll see you in June.
All right, thank you very much to Andy Moog, the winning goaltender for the Edmonton Oilers tonight. I know we're going somewhere. It's the Dave Hodge. All right, Dave.
Howie Glenn Sather said he felt justified in saying that the Islanders had changed the way hockey, the Oilers had changed the way hockey has being played these days, just as the Islanders have done in their time as champions. I think it's true. This is a team that has got everything, but has got one thing more than anything else, and that is speed.
There's no doubt about it. They have speed, oodles of it, skill and finesse, and these are the things that sells tickets and that makes hockey just the tremendously interesting game it is. With some bodily contact, it's just super. When violence and tough checking tactics are used continually, it takes away, I would think, a little bit from the entertainment. But certainly like Russia's in 72 and ever since then, and Glenn Sather's team now, I hope minor hockey across the country, first of all, starts to teach the kids to skate, to handle the puck, to skate and handle the puck and think. Speed, skill, and finesse. And every team in the National Hockey League could be like the Oilers.
Well, you know, I'll tell you, if these two teams ever play in the final again, I'm going to call them Edmonton and New York, because I have single-handedly created the newest expansion franchise in the NHL tonight, the Oilanders, and I've had it. How about Messier winning the Conn Smythe? I said to him at the time it was probably a close vote. I didn't mean to suggest that he snuck in as the winner, but I really do think that there were two or three others that had to have received votes, and while my vote would indeed have gone to Messier, Lowe, Gretzky, Cure, Moog, the way he played. Really.
Well, the Oilers got, Dave, exactly what they needed. First of all, they got tremendous leadership from Glenn Sather, and I'm very, very happy that he won this. He's taken an unmerciful beating from the fans here in this area, and hey, if anyone deserves the Stanley Cup, it's Sather. They got excellent goaltending. Moog and Fuhr played very, very well. Fuhr, as I said off the top of the show, the first two out of the first three games, I think he won himself. Gretzky and Messier just gave them what they needed up front, big, strong, skillful, hard-skating forwards, and Lowe and Coffey on defense. Oh, I just love those pair. Great guys.
Glenn Sather isn't the coach of the year. He should be executive of the year. Don Cherry said that many times. Glenn Sather made a big, big trade that nobody knew was really big when he made it, when he got Kevin McClellan from the Pittsburgh Penguins. He is with John Wells now in the Edmonton room.
Okay, Dave, it's a long way from Baltimore to Edmonton in the Stanley Cup Championship, but that's the route that Kevin McClellan has taken since the trade with the Edmonton Oilers and the Pittsburgh Penguins. Well, you wouldn't have had much luck in Pittsburgh this year, but it's been a great year for you in Edmonton.
Well, the trade worked out well for me. I played on a Stanley Cup team, and I had to come here and work hard, and they gave me a chance, and here I am now in the Stanley Cup.
Kevin, you played a pretty big role in the Stanley Cup victory for the Edmonton Oilers. You've been told that before.
Yeah, they told me I had to come here and play a checking game on defense, and that's what I did, and I tried to do the job well for them.
When did the Oilers, in your opinion, start believing that the Islanders could really be beaten?
Well, after we beat them the first game 1-0, we knew that we had them beat, and got champagne on my eyes.
I know it hurts a little bit too, doesn't it? Wipe it out, okay.
Okay.
Billy Smith was a problem to solve for the Oilers. You solved it in game one.
Well, we knew we had to get to him. We were keeping the puck low on the ice, and eventually we started scoring goals, and we needed those goals to win the game.
Any kind of a championship team in your background before?
In Oshawa, I always played on OMHA championships, but I've never been on nothing this big.
Okay, thanks
Thank
very much,
very
Kevin
much.
McClellan. Don Jackson is here somewhere, I understand. Very little bit of chaos in this dressing room. Don Jackson, congratulations on the victory. I keep asking about the tense moments in the third period, but I think it's very important the way that the Islanders came back, did not give up, and obviously scared the Oilers a little bit in the third period.
We definitely had to give our heads a little shake there, and everybody just started to come through after that first minute of the third period. We just got back to our regular game, and we just kept taking it to them.
What does the trophy mean as you stand here amongst the champagne and all the cheering fans?
That's a tough question. It's been a long, drawn-out process, and the Oilers have been waiting for a long time, and it's been a long, drawn-out process for myself and my career, and as you can see, everybody's as happy as can be.
I don't suppose there are happier moments anyway, anytime. Thank you very much to Don Jackson. Here again, Dave Hodge.
To say that our Stanley Cup wrap-up continues shortly.
Last year, for the first time, Americans were picked first and third in the NHL draft. What will be the story this year in the 84 draft, June 9th in Montreal? Well, no doubt one story will be the sensational Mario Lemieux from Laval, who has rewritten the junior record books in the province of Quebec. For the first time, Canadian viewers will be able to follow their favorite team's selections as Sports Weekend brings you a television first. It's live coverage of the NHL draft from the Montreal Forum. See it Saturday, June 9th.
We continue in the Oiler dressing room, and defenseman Randy Gregg with me right now. You guys are supposed to be drinking that champagne, not pouring it all over each other.
There's a lot around, I'll tell you what, the guys deserve it. They can do anything they want with it.
Game plan for you and your celebration next 10 days or so. Is it time to sit back and relax and take stock of what's happened?
I think a lot of the guys are going to be ready to come out tomorrow and practice at 11. That's the way this team is. We had a number of different difficulties during the series. We had Winnipeg and then Calgary, Minnesota. We're ready to take on somebody else, and I know tomorrow most of the guys will get up at 10 and be ready to come right down again.
You look back to that Calgary Flames series still at this point as saying it did something special for the Edmonton Oilers to get them this far.
It was one of the biggest ones. We had to become very disciplined defensively, and I think that showed in the games against New York that we could tighten up a lot. Our forwards, I want to hug them all because they just came back and made it very, very easy for us.
Quick thought, your feeling right now. How do you describe it?
I can't, to tell you the truth, maybe a little disappointment because it's over, but I'm so darn happy. But I want to share this with you a little bit.
Yeah, well, thanks very much, Doctor.
Thank you.
Just what I really needed. Glenn Anderson, come on up here for a second. Glenn Anderson. Okay, quick thought, Glenn Anderson, about this Edmonton Oilers team. How do you describe this team?
I think they're pretty explosive, but they give them the opportunity. If you take the opportunity away from them, I don't think they could be that explosive. But we've proved in the last four or five games here in the finals that if you give us a chance, we're going to jump on it. And if you give us an inch, we're going to take a mile.
You did take a mile against the Islanders, didn't you?
Well, you can't take anything away from them because they play great hockey. And I'm happy that we won the championship. And we're looking forward to next year. And I'll make sure we do it again.
Thank you very much. All right, Dave.
Here's Al Arbor, the coach of the four-time champion New York Islanders. I suggested to Bill Torrey that the thought that might nag you when you look back on this series is that you got the scoring power too late, a couple of quick goals in the first minute of the third period. Yet to turn that around, it almost typifies what this team has stood for. This was a team that really didn't play all that well, and certainly with not many healthy bodies in the three games here in Edmonton, and yet the last time out of that dressing room, they gave it what they had.
Well, yeah, they gave it a real good shot. I'm very, very proud of them. Even in defeat, because there's so much adversity that's faced our team, especially in the playoffs. with all the injuries and the other things that have happened, and I had to play a lot of players way too much in those other series to get here, and at the end it took its toll. It didn't have any more to give.
The Oilers are a team that we all knew were capable of beating anybody by whatever score, and I'm sure as you studied for this series and got your team ready, you probably had a fear that if you were going to lose, it just might be by big scores in a couple of games. This is a team that is tough to control.
Well, there's no doubt about that. You know, I've been fearing this stuff for 3 years now. You could see the talent and the way they were coming around. I felt that, you know, if we could have got that first game in our building, that would have really been a big help to us, because we could have gone back to our building. We got here and you know, we struggled the last minute of the second period, and that was a hockey game right there. And the other game, well, we just didn't get out of the shoot at all. We had a real bad night, and things weren't going for us tonight again. And when we got those goals, it was a little too late.
Al, I know you'd prefer to be spending a summer worrying about how you're going to defend the cup again. It's not going to be quite that summer. I hope it's an enjoyable one.
Well, thank you very much.
Our coverage of the 1984 Stanley Cup Final will continue in a moment. The Edmonton Oilers are the new Stanley Cup champions, 5-2 in game number 5. At this time every season, we say thanks to some people, and it must seem that we're thanking the same people every year, but they do change as the rosters of your favorite team. The NHL coaches change, and they're a terrifically cooperative group of 21 people. We thank our major sponsor, Molson Breweries of Canada. We are glad they don't change, and our other advertisers. We thank a lot of unseen people on our technical crews as cities change, their prowess does not. A lot of unseen people at the CBC generally and at Canadian Sports Network. We look ahead to the award show on June 4th, to the draft on June 9th, and as we look back, in many ways, the NHL probably hasn't had many better playoff seasons. Thank you and good night from all of us at Hockey Night in Canada.
In hockey broadcasting for over 25 years. Canadian Tire. There's more to Canadian Tire than tires. Canadian General Electric. We bring good things to life. Esso, you make us better. And by Ford of Canada. At Ford, quality is job one. Driving is believing.
This is CBC.
Congratulations, Edmonton Oilers from XT5.
Good evening. The hockey game is over, but the party has just begun. And through the facilities of Hockey Night in Canada and Molson Alberta Breweries, we would like to bring you some of the excitement and fun coming out of various parts of this city tonight as all Oiler fans celebrate the 1984 Stanley Cup victory tonight by the Edmonton Oilers. I'm Peter Watts, along with our Hockey Night in Canada telecast crew, happy to be able to bring you this special few minutes of party time. And we're going to start this evening at the Oiler dressing room, where John Wells is standing by with Charlie Huddy. Let's go there now. John?
Well, they've turned up the music, and the party is really getting underway in the Oiler dressing room right now. Charlie Huddy joins me. Charlie, some quick thoughts about the emotion. Let's say, what is it now, half an hour after game time, half an hour after the presentation?
It's hard to describe right now. No doubt everybody's excited, and it's just an unbelievable feeling. I'm sure it'll take a couple of days for me anyways till it really sinks in and realize what we've done.
What have you accomplished? How difficult is it to win the Stanley Cup?
It was a tough task for us, no doubt, playing against the four-time champions. They wanted to make it five, and we came out and we worked hard. I think the key game was the first game in the island, and going in there not having beaten them in that many times, and we went in and beat them 1-0 and had a bad second game, but we knew we were coming home with three games at home, and we took it from there, and it's just a great feeling.
I've asked a couple of other players tonight, how important was the Calgary series to the Oilers' success in going all the way?
Well, fortunately, I didn't play in the last three, but I think everybody learned a great lesson from it. We thought we were going to go through our conference with no problem at all, and they took us to seven games, and we realized what we were going to have to do to go right to the finals again. They came out hitting, and we responded. We were hitting and working hard, and against the Islanders, we changed our game plan a little bit, and we worked hard along the boards and in the corners, and I think we won all the little battles, and that's what it takes.
Charlie, going into game five tonight, you had to be very confident. You had to know it was there for the taking.
Yeah, I think everybody figured we had a little bit of an edge, but we knew that they weren't going to quit, and we had to go out there and work hard. There's no way anybody or any of us wanted to go back to New York and on a 5.5-hour flight all the way back there and go back and face them and also their crowd. And everybody responded real well with the exception of about 2 minutes in the third period.
Okay, thanks very much, Charlie Huddy. Congratulations once again. All right, it's a strange thing what will happen when a Stanley Cup comes to town. But we have the mayor here and Lawrence Dakar and Olivia Beauty. But I think maybe more importantly, Lawrence Dakar, Mayor Dakar, and Peter Pocklington are talking here, I guess possibly over the Stanley Cup, and that makes things a little easier.
Peter Pocklington gave me a good bottle of champagne. We are friends again. This is fantastic. A great honor to our city. I'm hoarse because that last 5 minutes was the hardest 5 minutes of my life. A tremendous honor for our city. Great ambassadors. A great city to be part of.
All right, who's in charge of the party? Is Olivia going to throw
Olivia
it?
Olivia is the captain.
All right, Olivia, better let everybody know. Is there a parade plan? What have you got going?
John, everything's under control. We've been planning this for weeks. We knew they would do it, but we didn't want to announce it till today. It's Tuesday, a parade down Jasper Avenue, starting at 107th Street, going east to 99th Street, 99th Street north to City Hall, and the rally will take place at City Hall. We're asking everyone to come out with their orange scarves, their pom-poms, to show the Oilers that we know what they've done to put Edmonton on the map, and let's show them we really appreciate them.
All right, sounds like you're running out of gas, but tell us about the parade. Have you been watching films of the old Montreal Canadiens Stanley Cup victory parades? Do you know how to throw one of these things?
Look, we're not taking lessons from anybody. We got our own system here, and you're going to see the best parade in town.
In town or in the province?
Well, in the country, I meant.
Okay, well, we're going to talk to your pal Peter Pocklington here in just a moment, but right now, let's go to Bruce Winter.
Thank you, John. Outside the dressing room, it's rather quiet at the moment. I have Billy Warwick, and a good friend of his is the man who brought hockey to Edmonton, at least professional hockey, years ago, Bill Hunter. How would he feel tonight, Billy?
Well, I think Bill would be a very proud man. I didn't see Bill down here tonight after the game, but I saw him with his lovely wife in the stands. He's a guy that deserves a tremendous amount of credit. The World Hockey Association would have never got off the ground if it hadn't for Bill Hunter. And then Bill Hunter brought in good people, and here's what they got. We have a Stanley Cup. It's just wonderful, and the greatest thing that ever happened to Edmonton and Western Canada and Alberta is the Stanley Cup.
The thing about it, Billy, was that somebody took a gamble, was willing to build a facility like this, and it ends up in a Stanley Cup tonight.
Well, I can remember when Dr. Allard and Bill Hunter and St. Tom were going to build their own rink, and I think they were kind of pushing the Exhibition Association or forced them into build one, and maybe that had a lot to do with it, and Bill Hunter was behind that, and all of a sudden the Exhibition picked the tiger by the tail, and we're lucky when they did it, because I think it was only 14 or 15 million at the time that they built it. Today this would cost maybe 30, 40 million. So our timing was right, everything was perfect, and I'd like to say to Buckets Fleming in 1963, he and I were talking, and Buckets says, what do you think? This was in our restaurant. What do you think, Billy? I said, there'll be National Hockey League in Edmonton within 10 years. You mark my words. And Buckets, he quoted me on it. And just about 10 years after we talked about it, the Oilers were here in the National Hockey League.
Did you predict they'd win a cup in 21 years later?
No, but I'll tell you, the cream always comes to the top, and it sure came to the top tonight.
Billy Warwick, thanks very much. The man who's really in charge of the Edmonton Oilers is standing by with John Wells in the dressing room, John Wells and Peter Pocklington.
Interesting to note, as we mentioned just a few moments ago, that Peter Pocklington and Lawrence Decorah, the mayor of Edmonton, have buried the hatchet. And I guess that's what a Stanley Cup victory does for a couple of people, although I really think it was buried before tonight, wasn't it?
Oh, I think so. You know, quite frankly, the thrill and excitement of a Stanley Cup, John, even brings socialists and capitalists together.
Peter, very prophetic remarks about 1979, when you did say that the Edmonton Oilers, your hockey team, would win the Stanley Cup in 5 years. You're right on schedule, and I want to know how you knew.
Well, quite frankly, I'm a believer that one becomes what one thinks about. And maybe I was naive in believing I could do it in 5 years, but came back to my people and said, Glenn, I've committed myself. This is our goal. Glenn said, no question, I can do it. And maybe he was naive too, but we all believed, and that's been our goal here in the club for 5 years. And when you believe something that strongly, it happens.
Anxious moments, third period. I talked to you in the second intermission. You're up 4-0. Before you got back to your seat, I know it was 4-2.
You're so right. I damn near died, because you said, you remember the last time I talked to you, Peter, it was in L.A., and you went back to your seat on a 5-0 lead and lost. I said, come on now, John, that isn't going to happen. By the time I got back to my seat and saw 4-2, I thought you were the one that was prophetic.
Tell me about what your plans are for the Edmonton Oilers in a party sense or what. I know it's going to be quite private, but what are you going to do for your guys?
We just want to get away with our wives and the Oilers, and I guess settle down, enjoy the high while we've got it. It's one of the most exciting things that's ever happened to me in my whole life, John. And
it's more fun than making money, is it?
Yes, I guess it is. There's no question about it.
Thank you very much, Peter.
Thanks,
Coach Muckler is here with me for just a second. John, congratulations to you. Tell me about this series and the New York Islanders. Tell me how you coach the Edmonton Oilers to believe in themselves.
Well, first of all, I want to congratulate the Islanders. They're a terrific hockey club. They have a lot of character.
They got me again.
Enjoy it. It's great. It's an unbelievable series. We walked into Long Island not knowing whether we could win in there, and we won the first game 1-0 and played exceptionally well. Then we're defeated 6-1 the second game, but we came out, we did our job, we were coming home with one win, and we felt that we had to beat the Islanders at home. We didn't want to go back to Long Island, because they are such an explosive hockey club. But I thought, with the younger leagues that we have here, we utilized our speed, and their defense had considerable amount of trouble. And they kept clogging up the front of the net on us, and we had to get some of those people out of there. So we went wide on them and used their speed and took them away from front of net and kept hitting that late person coming in, and eventually we broke them open in the third and fourth game.
You also solved the problem of Billy Smith. Now, I don't know if that was psychological to the Edmonton Oilers after last year. There was a lot written and said about Billy Smith and why you couldn't beat the Islanders in 10 games.
Well, I didn't think Billy Smith played as well this year as he did last year. He was awesome last year, but I have to give a lot of credit to the fans at Edmonton. They helped us break him. I mean, they were fabulous. I mean, they give Billy an awful beating, and certainly so.
How big a factor was the fan response? I know all the players and the coaching staff talked about it, but how big a factor? What can you place on that, the reaction and the response you got from fans in Edmonton?
Oh, I thought, you know, coming home and playing three games here, that home ice wouldn't make a difference. But with the reaction of the fans, they were behind us 150%, and they were worth one goal at least. I mean, our guys got excited. Flynn played it right. He let the Islanders go on the ice first. We came out second for our ovation, and the fans, they just stood up and cheered for 3.5 minutes. And I know what it's like being on the road, listening to the opposition fans cheer like the Edmonton fans for 3.5 minutes. It has to affect you.
Let me put you on the spot quickly. Are you the head coach next year?
Well, right now, John, I'm enjoying myself. I'm up in heaven.
I knew I wasn't going to get an answer to that one. Thank you very much to John Muckler. Here's Bruce Winter.
Thank you, John Wells. We have a couple of super fans. There's been a lot said about the emotion of the fans here in Edmonton. We have Dave Ash and Sandy Monteith. Likely during the games you saw them with their horns and everything. They are from Saskatchewan. And first of all, Dave, why do you do this?
Well, we don't have an NHL team in Regina or in Saskatchewan yet. And the Oilers are just about the closest for us. So I come here and I cheer my heart out for the Oilers.
Sandy, you guys went to a lot of work to prepare. Why do this in the playoffs?
Well, we've been doing it all year long, actually. We cheer for the Riders back home. And Dave's been down here for every game. I just got down here for this one.
I think the players might agree that you were probably some sort of an influence that they didn't expect. Would you agree with that? You certainly got the crowd going well.
It was explained to me a couple times, and I'll just repeat what was said to me. It was, you've got your five players forwards, and three forwards, two defensemen, and a goalie comprising six players. I was referred to as a seventh player on the team.
Must make you feel good.
It does. It's great because we have 17,000 fans out there, and I'm sitting there leading them, and they're all clapping at the same time. It's a great feeling.
How could you afford to come down and spend all the time you spent here?
I'm sponsored by a tour company in Regina called Dash Tours, and I come to all the games for them and run the tours for them, and that's how I get on the buses. The experience I've got in doing this, you may be familiar with the character of Gainer the Gopher in Regina. I'm the fellow that does him in Regina, so now I can get outside the uniform and do it here.
Dave Ash, a man of many talents, we're going to give you one more chance. You've got some fans there behind you. Give us the cheers. Okay, Peter.
Thank you, Bruce, very much. We'll be back to both Bruce and John in just a moment. You know, there's been a 13-year history of the Edmonton Oilers franchise, eight in the WHA, five in the NHL, and this is the first time that the Oilers franchise has ever emerged as the champions of the league it's played in. It has indeed been quite a year. This, of course, is, of course, the first Stanley Cup victory for the Edmonton Oilers, but the club has a rich playoff history, which began with its first season in the NHL. Here's a report from John Wells.
That first year, the Oilers made the playoffs only to lose in the first round to the Philadelphia Flyers. The man who scored the winning goal in the second overtime period was a brash young forward, Ken Linsman. Linsman was destined to join the Oilers 2 years later. The next year, an even greater high, a memorable series against the Montreal Canadiens. A young goaltender named Andy Moog, a seventh-round draft pick in 1980, moved into the spotlight. The Oilers strolled into Montreal and beat the mighty Canadiens at the Forum in the first two games of the series. They came home to a tumultuous welcome and eliminated the Habs in three straight. The season ended six games later. The Islanders knocked the Oilers out of the quarterfinals en route to their second Stanley Cup. In the Oilers' third season, continued improvement in the standings and on the ice. By this time, Sather had added players like Yari Kurri, Paul Coffey, and Grant Fuhr. All players who could enhance Gretzky's talents. All players who fit the Sather mold. A blend of talents, character, and determination. But the season ended on a sour note. An upset 3-2 loss to the Los Angeles Kings in the first round of the playoffs. It was time for soul-searching for the boss.
The team was ready to play then. I really feel that they're so worried about losing that they went out and lost. But, you know, that year we hardly played Paul Coffey. I mean, he had a tough year. It was his sophomore year, and he had a lot of self-doubts. Paul is 10 times a hockey player now than he was then. Our team has come a long way. We weren't really ready to be as good as we were. I guess people expected a lot from the hockey team then. To be a championship hockey team, you have to grow into the role. You just can't have one great season and then be a Stanley Cup champion. It doesn't work like that.
The nightmare of year three was all the motivation the Oilers needed as the 82-83 season got underway. The Oilers charged out of the starting gate, made a shambles of the Smythe division, and tied for second overall. They defeated Winnipeg, Calgary, and Chicago en route to another date with the Islanders, this time in the Stanley Cup Final. But Billy Smith proved to be too big an obstacle. And the Oilers were finished in four.
And all that, of course, the lead up to this year's Stanley Cup Final Series. And this time, the Oilers have emerged victorious tonight, 5-2 over the New York Islanders, the Edmonton Oilers' first ever Stanley Cup triumph. One of the architects of the Oilers franchise in the last 5 years is the chief scout of the team, Barry Fraser. And right now, he's standing by live in the victorious Oilers dressing room with John Wells. Let's go there now. John?
This party in the Edmonton Oilers dressing room is a long way from over, and the celebration that this town is going to see this weekend is a long way from over, too. Barry Fraser, chief scout, I guess that's what we call you, director of player personnel. I know you're a happy guy, and I know you're pretty silly because you're wearing ultra suede in this dressing room.
I don't really care, and I've never worn the jacket before, but I'll tell you what a great feeling. I really don't know how to describe it yet, but we're going to have one hell of a party in this town, and it's going to last 2 weeks.
I think you might be right. You've done a lot to build the Edmonton Oilers, mostly from scratch. It must be very pleasing to a guy like you to sit back and see the efforts of that come forth in a Stanley Cup championship.
It sure is, and think of all the good guys I got working with me, Lauren Davis and Eddie Chadwick, Ace Billy, Larry Kish, the part-time guys, Matty Bison in Finland. They've all done a fantastic job, and they're a big part of this thing, and everybody in this room contributed in one way or another, and it's just a fantastic feeling.
Break it down for me, Barry. One factor that won the Stanley Cup for the Edmonton Oilers.
Well, I would say their maturity on the ice and the acquisition of Kevin McClellan.
Maturity on the ice. I think the cops are here.
Two.
I don't know. Barry, you don't really need to change many things on a hockey club like this, do you?
Well, sometimes as you sit still, time's got to keep it up on you. We've got a lot of good young kids that are going to be battling some of these veterans in training camp for a job, and we'll let the chips fall where they may.
That's a long time from now.
Yeah,
enjoy
sure
the party
is.
For
yeah,
now.
Yeah, I will.
Thanks
Thank
very
you
much,
very
Barry
much.
Fraser. Dave Semenko. Happy time for a kid from Brandon, just near my hometown, David, so we can share in this celebration a little bit. Your feelings after you've had a chance about an hour for it to sink in.
I don't know. This feeling is just building and building since final whistle I was a little confused. I didn't know how to react. And now this has been going on. I know what it's all about now, and I know why those guys worked so hard to retain this thing. I know why they kept it for so long.
Dave, you got a lot of ice time in the playoffs, and that made a difference to the way you performed. Is that not a correct assessment?
Oh yeah, I knew playing with Wayne, I was getting a lot of chances, a lot of ice time, and this felt great. After having a real short season, not playing that much, this is my favorite time of year.
Tell you, somebody had to be tall to get up there and get champagne on you with your skates on. Is there any point where the pressure got to be just too much for the Oilers?
No, it was.
I mean, a lot of guys might not have slept at night. What was going on in the past week?
I managed to get a little sleep every night, a little more. Managed to only toss and turn for 2 hours last night. The night before it was five. This afternoon it was just a wreck. I didn't know what to do, and I tried to think about different things, but there's one thing on my mind, is winning this cup and what would happen.
I know I was talking to you before the game. You're sitting out at the bench, what was it, 3 hours before the game, yeah, with a cup of coffee in your bathrobe. You seemed relaxed then. Was that a facade? Was that a different side that we don't usually see of you?
No, once I got to the rink, I was okay. Once I got here, it was all right. Once we got to the beginning of the period and stuff like that, then I started really get excited, really nervous. We had a good lead. Then I started to feel good again. Came out in the third, and all of a sudden, but uh-oh. These guys are coming. They want it.
One single factor, quickly, David, why the Edmonton Oilers are the Stanley Cup champions. Is there one word, one way to describe how you won or why you won?
Because we have a... it's not one word. It's just 20 guys out there working their butts off to achieve one thing. And a combination of everything.
Thank you very much, Dave. I'm happy for you. All right, here's Bruce.
Thank you very much, John. We have three people out here. The first lady I'd like to talk to is Vicki Moss. Vicki, what's your feelings right now?
I don't know what to say. Well, I'm very, very happy, and the boys are so happy. I'm so glad for them that the pressure's off, and they can finally have a great summer and relax and not have to think about anything until September. So I'm just happy that we're all happy. And
Wayne took a lot of heat from us in the media when he wasn't playing well and scoring. Can you let us in on any insight of how he handled that when he was away from the rink?
It saddened him a little bit, waking up every morning and getting to the paper and reading a little bit about what the press was writing. You know, they were quite negative about it, and they kept reminding him about it. And I think it's harder when you see it all the time. And actually, if he weren't to listen to anything and just go out and do what he's supposed to do, I think it would have been okay. But being reminded it all the time, it was quite hard. And
does he get mad? Does he yell and
no,
shout?
He never gets mad. He just goes with the flow, and he says, well, I'm just going to do my best, and he gives it 100%. If it doesn't happen, it doesn't. But, we don't want him to get negative or down about things. And so, actually, I try to hide the paper from him.
Peter Zosky is a well-known writer and broadcaster and number one Oiler fan. And, Peter, give for me some sort of inkling on why we have this mayhem when we have such a championship won. It happens all the time.
I wonder if it ever happens to the degree that it's happening here now, though. I just think because it's a happy thing. Nothing else in life has a perfect ending, right? Your marriage doesn't have a perfect ending. Your kid doesn't have a perfect ending. Your job doesn't have a perfect ending. Your political career doesn't have a perfect ending. But a hockey season has a perfect ending. I mean, this is it. There's nowhere to go from here. You can just say, whoopee, we did it. There's no qualifications. No one can say, sure, we won, but they voted against us, or sure, we won, but it was, I mean, it's a total victory. It's a perfect, complete thing. I think that's why people love it. It's fun. That was the thing the guys were saying inside this group. This is fun. You know, as there's Dave Lumley playing his heart out, goes back there and says, I like doing this. Well, I think that's the secret. People like victory, perfect victory. That's what this is.
Peter, thank you very much. The other Peter, just moving a little closer so we can have a little chat one more time here. Your thought on when you signed that napkin and got that deal with Nelson Skalbania, now in perspective with a cup in your back pocket.
I'll tell you, that's a lot of years back. It's about 8 years ago this fall. I was in the steak loft with Eva, and we were having dinner, and Nelson was having a press conference. And I thought, my God, does that look fun? And went over and made a deal during the press conference and bought half the team. From then, my problem started. All of a sudden, the responsibility of what I had done bore in, and I had to take it seriously. The press were beating my skull during the first year, and I guess got involved. And I got involved to the point where it became part of me.
Peter Zosky just mentioned the players are having fun.
Oh, they sure are.
With what you've gone through in the last year and a half now, are you having fun?
Oh, this has been one of my great highs of my whole life. In fact, Peter touched on another high last year, the political event where Brian Mulroney won, I lost. It was a high, but nothing like this. This was something that 8 years of myself had gone into it. All of a sudden, the dream had come true, and as Peter pointed out, every other walk of life you end up being dashed on the rocks occasionally. This, it happened. All of Alberta is going crazy, and maybe even Canada.
Thank you both so much. Thank you, Vicki. We'll go back in the dressing room now, and John Wells.
Not one of the more familiar faces on the Edmonton Oilers. This is Mike Zainier, who's been the backup goaltender for the last two victories in this Stanley Cup Final Series. Two nights ago, when you're sitting in the dressing room, tell me what's going through your mind.
Well, you know, Andy was playing such a good game, and I was just happy to be part of this organization, and I was excited to be back up.
What about tonight, third period, when Andy Moog goes down?
all of a sudden it might have meant an appearance in the Stanley Cup Final?
I was getting nervous, but I was also excited. You know, it was a chance to play, but fortunately Andy wasn't hurt and he finished off the game.
All right, your feelings. You haven't been a big part of the Oilers victory in a lot of ways, but you've been with this hockey club. What does it feel from that side of things? Are you still part of the championship? Do you feel good?
Well, you know, we practiced with this club for 2 months since we finished in Moncton and everything, and it's just such a good bunch of guys and such a great organization, and just great to be part of the...
Okay, thanks very much, Mike. Dave Hunter is down here, and I just want a quick word with Dave before we leave the Oilers dressing room. I know it was a lot tougher standing behind the glass and not playing in the last two games, Dave, but you still have to be excited and happy about this victory.
I don't think I ever had a feeling like this. I don't know if I don't think it can sink in for about 2 days. I don't know if you dream as a kid to come up and you win the Stanley Cup and you finally do it. It hasn't sank in yet. And I don't think I've been that nervous in a hockey game just sitting out. I know what the fans feel like now, and I almost appreciate the fans more and everybody in the city of Edmonton.
I know I watched in the Zamboni sitting down there watching the hockey game, and you seemed a lot more nervous, a lot more upset.
Well, I never had a feeling like that. When they come out and score two quick goals, I couldn't even watch it. I had to turn and go back out, but it's a feeling. And you're more nervous because you're not out there playing, I guess, but I never had a feeling like this tonight. I just can't say it.
You're the first of the Hunter brothers to win a Stanley Cup, but I know you're going to have a great summer with a Stanley Cup ring and pictures that you'll be able to take home at your hotel.
You know, the funny thing, I'm going to have to bug them guys all summer, and that's a great feeling. I'm going to have to be on their case all summer. And you know, when you're winning something like this, and they haven't yet, but you know, they're good hockey players, great hockey players, but I'm going to be on their case all for the whole summer.
Have a good summer. I know you'll enjoy it more than last year. Well, that's pretty well the story here from the Oilers dressing room. The party will continue right through the weekend for the Edmonton Oilers, who have won their first Stanley Cup championship, and deservedly so, with their victory over the New York Islanders. We'll be around here for a while having a good time, and right now, it's back to Peter Watt.
Thank you, John, very much. And right now, let's go over to Rascals for reports from Donna Krasinski.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Excitement and noise were tough to contain in this celebration at a bar called Rascals.
I think it's the best they ever, ever had. They deserve it.
Montreal went down, and Islanders, oh, so sorry.
Okay.
Hey, we go with the Oilers all the way.
Andy Morgan, number one. Now you wanted to know who Billy Smith is. Who is Andy Morgan?
This is Stanley Cup number one for Edmonton. Already the fans are looking to the future.
Drive for two! Drive for two! Drive for two! Drive for five! Drive
for five! Cup is here where it belongs. All right, what do you think?
How long do you think you'll have it here?
We're going to have it here for at least 10 years. I'm sure of it. Yes, we are.
Let's go for five. I'll take the five, and then I'll be happy.
Corey Van said to me, wow, this is happening in Edmonton. The Stanley Cup is finally here. This is a big story.
And judging by these fans, they should be partying long into the night. Donna Krasinski, CBC News, Edmonton.
So the party continues at a lot of places in Edmonton tonight. Let's go once more to the dressing room at the Northlands Coliseum and check in with John Wells and the party there. John?
Things have quieted down just a little bit outside the Oilers dressing room right now. The fans are leaving the Coliseum, some just standing around trying to get a glimpse of the players coming out. We just hope that... Well, things have quieted down outside the Oilers dressing room right now. The fans are milling about, but most of them have left, and the players are still inside celebrating as they probably should be. So as far as this locale is concerned on our special, I think that we probably accomplished all that we can. So let's now turn it back to Peter Watts at the studio.
One of the lovely things about live television, it was supposed to be John, but it turned out to be Bruce, and anyway, the party goes on, as you can see. After nipping the Islanders 1-0 in the opening game of the Stanley Cup Finals, the Oilers fell back into old habits in losing in Game 2. But that newfound maturity that we had heard so much about through the playoffs really showed itself in games 3 and 4 and again tonight in game 5. And we saw more evidence that the Oilers have arrived as one of the truly great teams in the NHL. Here's a quick look back in music and picture form at the first 4 games of the Oilers-Islanders series.